as the choir repositions and Stephanie, our cellist, gets all set, we're going to move into a second portion of the concert where Stephanie will play a piece by Bach, and we'll follow by something very modern and extremely different than the piece you'll hear from her. So just give us a moment, we will make our way to our positions.
Thank you.
I mentioned at the beginning of the concert, it's a real pleasure to work with people who are not only really talented and, for the most part, are pretty nice, but they're generous. They're generous. When I ask them, hey, I know it's summer break, but you're crazy, golly, and you can't stop working, has another concert to do, you want to play? They all said, yeah, sure, that sounds like fun. It's a real pleasure to work with people like Ed and Diana and Gail and Adam and Andy and all the folks that are here tonight. So your program has a little blurb from Ed about the piece, so you can read up on that. In the meantime, just enjoy this beautiful song.
Thank you.
So as I mentioned in the program, it's a real, I think it's really important thing for us to celebrate and explore the music of the past. But it's also important for us to remember that we are part of a living art in which people like my colleague friend Phil Spencer are still creating beautiful and exciting and interesting new music for us to explore and to share. And so Phil works at Julia Junior College, and we are junior college colleagues in Illinois. We participate in a professional organization, ACDA, American Choral Directors Association. Through that, got to know Phil a little bit, gotten to enjoy some of his fine compositions. And the piece that you're going to hear us perform of his tonight is one that I heard his choir do, and like most musicians, you hear things, you get excited by them, and then you try and do them yourself and experiment with it. So I asked Phil to just come up and share a couple of ideas about his own music. We'll perform the piece by Davis first, and we'll follow it right away with Phil's piece. But why don't you come and tell us a little bit about it before we perform it?
Thank you, Andy. Thank you for this opportunity. I composed this piece about 1 year ago for one of my choirs at Julia Junior College. I am also intrigued by texts about music, and this one is taken from a much longer poem by Walt Whitman entitled Song of Myself. I haven't been able to find any other musical settings of these particular words to date. The piece is in three very concise sections. In fact, it takes less time to sing the piece than it does to talk about it. The refrain, which begins the piece and is repeated two more times, consists of vocal lines with many large, ascending, aspiring intervals on the words, I hear the sound I love, culminating in the words, the sound of the human voice, sung the second time a cappella. An exuberant, rhythmic piano accompaniment otherwise supports the voices in this first section. The second section includes the words, I hear all sounds running together, combined, fused, or followed. It begins with a double canon or round, with alto and bass repeating one theme at the octave, and soprano and tenor repeating a second theme at the interval of the 12th. These four contrapuntal lines layered together over the piano are meant to illustrate the words running together. Following all of this hectic activity, the words combined and fused are set in a series of increasingly compact chords, concluding with the word following as a three-note motive in every voice, but with slightly different intervals used each time. As singers, we often follow each other, but we retain our individuality as well. The third and briefest section is just a single phrase, now I will do nothing but listen. Each voice sings a simple C pitch as an ascending and descending octave, the most basic and elemental thing a singer can do. But the piano adds an elemental uncertainty by inserting an F sharp in between the C's to create a series of tritones called the devil in music. In other words, should our response to hearing the human voice in song be merely to listen appreciatively or to join in the singing? Ask Andy or any other choral director if you were in doubt about the correct answer. So, again, I want to express my sincere gratitude to Andy and to all of you singers for programming and performing I Hear the Song I Love on this marvelous concert this evening.
Oh,
seem to go through a concert without programming something English. So the Dahlias, even though his name, his music doesn't sound very English, he was English. But this music sounds English as well. And so these folk songs are really fun, and I enjoy taking things that don't really belong together, kind of making new stories out of them. So if you read the program note, it's supposed to kind of tell somewhat of an ill-fated love between these two characters. So at the beginning, we hear about the woman who can't quite say what's on her mind, because she's afraid of rejection. In the second song, things seem to be going okay until he is sent off to sea, in which he gives her the not too assuring idea that if he ever comes back, then they can get married. When she asks if she can go with him, his reply is, no way. And that led me to think that maybe he was looking for a reason to go. So in the last song, Bobby Schaffer, as we remember, kind of is the culmination. It's a really fun set of three songs. Hope you enjoy.
Oh,
so much. Such a fun group of songs to sing and to conduct. So we're going to invite up the band. I heard Phil's choir sing I Hear the Sound I Love in April, and when I told him, he said, I really like the song, I'd like to do that. And he said, well, if you're going to do that, can I come down and hear it? Well, yeah, you can come down, why don't you play the piano? If you're playing the piano, you know, it's stuff Phil taught. Phil is also a really fine jazz pianist. So this kind of came together in taking another idea from Phil, which was this piece. He did an arrangement of it, I did some adapting, and this is our version. We do have several featured performers. Ad Wiki is going to play some trumpet. We've got Andy Mays on bass, Connor Baltz over there on percussion, and Phil, and our featured vocal soloist is someone who always seems to get solos at No-Name Chorale concerts, so I don't have to change things around. That's Aaron Coughlin, So, this is a real departure from the rest of the music we've performed, but we hope that you enjoy this change of pace. done this conference, the real experiment, as I mentioned, we come together just for this week for a couple of rehearsals. We're always inviting and incorporating new singers, so it's a bit of a gamble all the time, but every time it seems to pay off, and it pays off because we're inviting more people from our musical community into partnership, and we're sharing with you as well. None of these people are getting paid to do any of this, and most of them usually get paid every time they open their mouth to sing or play. And that is a wonderful act of generosity, of spirit, and for what we do, for our art. I think a lot of these folks, like myself, really enjoy the opportunity to sing, enjoy you and perform, but we also enjoy the simple act of being together and making music, learning and growing from it. And I've been thinking a lot about the ways in which this budding thing, the No-Name Chorale, what it can stand for and what it can mean. And I hope that it means great music, and I hope it means community of us, the folks that do this stuff, and community of you, the folks that live in our community and want to come and listen to it and share with it. And in that spirit, I would like for us to make an offer, not to us, not as some kind of response to the musicians that you've heard, but to a worthy organization in our community that does work that feeds people's stomachs, where we're trying to feed sort of souls and spirits. There's an organization called the Belleville Interfaith Food Pantry that I've done concerts for, in which we've done offerings and done those kind of things. And so what I'm going to ask you to consider is that on your way out of the concert tonight, in lieu of what you might have spent to go to a concert in which people provide this kind of music, or maybe provide something that can help put food on someone's plate, and that we might be a part of making that happen. So on your way out tonight, there'll be folks at the doors there to collect, and any donations that you make will not go into my pockets, they will not buy sheet music, they will not, put gas in these people's cars who drove here to share this music with you. We will simply go to try and help people in our community who maybe don't have a voice and don't have what they need. So I hope you consider that on your way out. We are going to conclude with the most complex piece on our program. It's a piece that I've loved for many, many years, and I wanted the opportunity to share it with these singers, and we are going to dive headfirst into Frank Martin's Sanctus. It's a gorgeous and wonderful piece of music that offers so many rewarding things the more you listen to it. So if you're intrigued by what you hear, I encourage you to go find more music by Frank Martin, specifically the other movements of this mass. Can't thank you enough for coming out. I don't know if they would show up for this, so I can't thank you so much for coming and clapping for us and listening to us, and thank you to the choir and all my friends and colleagues for making this a reality, because I think it's a beautiful opportunity for us to share together, share with you in a time of the year when most musicians are off fishing and going boating and whatever. So thank you for your time.